Denmark has a proud history of harnessing the winds to generate power. The modern three-blade wind turbines were designed by the Danes, and they were the first to build an offshore wind farm. Today, over half their energy demand is covered by wind power, by far the largest in Europe. And they are looking to expand offshore. These are all the wind farms that are currently in production. These are being built, and these are approved. Now, hold on tight. All these are in the planning stage and are likely to be developed next. Wind power is expected to become Europe's main source of energy, and Denmark wants to produce so much that it can export to other countries. And they are investing billions on the construction of two artificial islands to serve as energy hubs. But was a nuclear supposed to be a better option? Don't wind turbines kill birds? Don't they disrupt marine ecosystems? I found one report that calculated that the wind industry is costing Denmark $270 million per year, and those tens of thousands of jobs it supposedly created was simply a shift from the non-subsidized sectors to the subsidized sector. Offshore energy is one of the most expensive sources of electricity, and the Danes are already paying amongst the highest prices in the EU. It sounds like something doesn't add up, but be careful. This report was actually financed by the American oil and gas lobby and is now widely discredited. With so much misinformation circling around in the mainstream media, let's see where we stand on whether it's good or bad that the oceans will become massive wind farms with hindsight. I'm glad to see you back for another video, and this one is a little bit different. I've never covered green energy before, but I promise you I'm gonna be as critical as you've come to expect from this channel. I just quickly want to let you know about our Patreon page. So I published a video this week about how I created this video from the initial idea to writing the script and editing the video. I made this available for all members, so that also includes people on a free plan. If you want to see this video, you can join for free. Or if you want to support me making these videos, you can choose one of the paid plans for as little as $2 per month. So now, is wind energy a disaster or is it genius? Let's go back a few years. In the beginning of the 20th century, wind power was already widely used around the world, primarily in remote places where energy distribution systems had not yet been installed. Wind turbines generated electricity that was typically used for lighting and charging batteries, but the industry was in decline after more and more farms were connected to the grid. But in the early 1970s, the industry would change for good. Denmark became a haven for hippies, with the neighborhood of Christiania in Copenhagen at its heart. In the neighboring island of Funen, at a state school, a young teacher was fired because he refused to cut his long hair. He was popular and good-looking, and he managed to collect a group of 40 followers to open a school for troubled youth. They started in a small community on the North Sea, but his approach to teaching was widely ridiculed. Students had to build their own houses, and they engaged in long philosophical group discussions. Nearby residents accused them of being a cult. But at some point, they decided to build a wind turbine, and the result was this monstrosity. But the ridicule turned to praise, as this turbine was not just the largest in the world, it was widely recognized as the best design on the market. And so, the Danish model was born. His work built on decades of Danish engineering, from the earlier models of Poel La Cour, which resembled Dutch windmills, to the Getzer turbine with three blades. But this was on a new level, and it came at a time where there was a growing desire for clean and renewable energy. Danish companies were soon building wind turbines to export around the world, and in the 1980s, they became the market leader. In 1991, they built the first offshore wind farm, and the smaller companies merged into a giant, Vestas, which produced a third of global wind turbines by the early 2000s. Vestas today is good for 16% of global wind turbine production, primarily due to increasing competition from China, but they are still the world's largest, followed by Siemens Gamesa, which acquired some of its expertise for the acquisitions of Danish companies like Bonus Energy, who provided the windmills for that first offshore wind farm. And they have headquartered their offshore business in Denmark. So Danish engineers are recognized as some of the industry's visionaries. But the story of that alternative school ended badly. They continued building dozens of such schools around the world, but its executives used this network to steal money from charities on a large scale. The school's founder is now on the run and is believed to be hiding in Mexico. With or without him, Denmark is moving on, and this is their vision. Offshore wind production has the capability to provide 80% of Europe's total energy consumption. And most of this potential lies in Northern Europe, where the waters are shallow and there's a lot of wind. Denmark lies at the center of this action, and they have Germany, by far the largest consumer in the EU, at a stone's throw away. Most wind energy is generated by onshore wind turbines, but offshore has a far greater potential. Ocean winds are stronger, faster, and more stable, and far larger wind turbines can be built on the water. In the mid-1990s, the largest wind turbine was about the size of the Statue of Liberty, but only 10 years later, they were already the size of the London Eye. By 2015, the biggest wind turbine was as tall as the Gherkin Tower in London. Imagine that the next time you see the London skyline. But today, a Chinese company is finishing construction of a wind turbine the size of the Eiffel Tower. This is the future of offshore wind, windmills the size of skyscrapers. And Europe is leading the industry. Of the 20 largest offshore wind farms, 12 are in the UK, 4 are in the Netherlands, 1 is in Denmark, and 1 is in Germany. Only one of them is outside of Europe, in Taiwan. Those massive wind farms still look like specks on a map, but the industry is expected to grow by 50 times over the next 3 decades. And won't that have severe negative consequences? You often hear that argument that wind turbines kill birds, but the truth is that most of our knowledge is about turbines that are on land. There are some studies that show how offshore wind farms affect migration patterns of birds, which means that birds need to consume more energy than they would have otherwise spent on breeding. Other studies have shown that bird populations drastically decreased in the vicinity of these wind farms, but there are also studies that show how bird fatalities can be reduced. The truth is that we don't yet fully understand how offshore wind farms will affect bird populations, but it's probably not a good thing. Another major concern is that while constructing these wind farms, massive piles are driven into the seabed, and the sound this generates travels for thousands of kilometers. This causes irreparable hearing damage in whales, dolphins, and other sea mammals. Just imagine if all these areas turned into construction zones, and the already busy North Sea traffic is forced into even smaller channels. That would turn the underwater experience into a nightmare of loud noises. On top of that, they are often built in shallow waters, which is exactly where fish like to mate and where fishermen like to fish. But this is, again, where researchers disagree. Some studies project that this will have a positive effect on fish populations because these wind farms can provide shelter. The turbine foundation could act as an artificial reef, attracting fish and predators and providing safety from fishermen. While other studies show that fish might choose to mate in less favorable conditions, causing a decline of fish stock. Either way, fishermen are screwed. It is true that offshore wind is twice as expensive as onshore wind, and over 3 times as expensive as power produced by natural gas. It is also true that Denmark pays relatively high prices for electricity, partly due to high taxes, but also because they're dependent on the weather. Just look at this chart. By the end of the decade, the difference between a favorable weather year and an unfavorable weather year would result in a nearly 3 times increase of electricity prices. The wind industry is still struggling to be profitable, and 99% of raw materials for wind turbines are sourced from outside the EU. The EU might reduce their reliance on Russia, but they will increase their reliance on China. Another major issue is that Europe's energy grids are not ready for offshore wind, and we simply have no way to store this electricity. The largest battery in the world, which is located in the desert of California, has the capacity to store the energy need of Denmark for 1 hour. And that's where Denmark's artificial islands can come in to help. These energy islands on either side of the country serve as distribution hubs. They allow offshore wind farms to be placed further out at sea, and they distribute wind power to the region that needs it the most. If you combine wind power with other sources of electricity and you distribute them intelligently across a larger region, you can reduce the impact that weather conditions have on electricity prices. Belgium already started construction on the world's first energy island, and Denmark's will be the first, second, and third. Offshore wind power is still in its infancy, and with every passing year, it is becoming cheaper, faster, and better. But there still exist a lot of problems, and a lot of research is still needed. But Denmark and the EU are confident enough to expect a tenfold increase of offshore electricity generation over the next couple of years.
So I hope you enjoyed this video about some of the pros and the cons of offshore wind energy. And I learned a lot of things. I think I was very biased against wind energy. When I just started researching this, I thought I was setting out on a debunking the wind energy scam kind of video. But I think the biggest thing that I learned is that it's an industry that's really just starting right now. And we have no idea where it's gonna be in 10 or 20 or 30 years. Whatever you judge wind energy on right now, it's not gonna be the same in a couple of years. So a lot of research is needed, and a lot of developments are happening very, very fast. So if you wanna see the video about how I made this, check out my Patreon page. You can watch it on a free plan, or if you wanna support me in making these videos, you can choose one of the paid plans starting at $2 per month. And here are two more videos that you can consider for your next watch.